Microphones are used by audio technicians to capture sound so they can be altered and reproduced. In live sound, we capture audio signals from a microphone, take them into the sound console, make changes, and then send them to the speakers. This allows the final sound to be much louder than the initial source, as well as giving us the ability to add other effects. The basic purpose of a microphone is to turn sound waves in the ear into audio signals in a cable. There are a variety of methods to achieve this. The most common in live sound applications is what is known as a dynamic microphone. This effectively operates as the inverse of a speaker. Inside the microphone, there is a small lightweight diaphragm connected to a movable coil of wire. This wire sits within the field of a permanent magnet. When the diaphragm is exposed to sound waves, it vibrates at the same frequency. This in turn vibrates the coil within the magnetic field, producing an alternating current. As the coil moves down, electrons flow one way, and as the coil moves back upward, the electrons flow the other way. This alternating current can be amplified and fed into a speaker, which will replicate the sound from the source. Dynamic microphones are cheap and easy to produce. They are good at maintaining high gain before feedback compared to other mic technologies, making them popular for live sound. They generally have worse dynamic range compared to other mic designs. Some dynamic mics are designed for vocal or specific instruments, while others have multiple pickups to try and target different frequency ranges. Another common microphone you will come across is a condenser microphone. These are based on the electrical component known as a capacitor, which used to be called condensers. A capacitor contains two charged plates, which are separated by a small air gap. A charge can be stored across the plate, but this depends on the distance between the plates. The further apart the plates are, the less charge can be stored. In a condenser microphone, the diaphragm is one of the two plates in a capacitor. A DC circuit from a battery or phantom power supplies the microphone with a continuous voltage to keep the plates charged. As the diaphragm interacts with sound waves, the distance between it and the other plate changes. This causes changes in voltage, which induce an AC current. Condenser microphones are far more sensitive than dynamic microphones. This makes them ideal for applications such as choirs or drum overheads, but can limit their use for some jobs as they are more susceptible to feedback or clipping from loud sound sources. Some other less common designs include contact and ribbon mics. Contact mics work by using an existing surface as their diaphragm. This allows them to be used for very specific applications with no risk of picking up any background noise. See the video above for some interesting demonstrations. Ribbon microphones are an older technology that is now quite uncommon. They work by suspending a thin metal ribbon in a magnetic field that acts as both the diaphragm and the conductive area. Because the internal ribbon is so thin and fragile, applying phantom power to a ribbon mic can permanently destroy the diaphragm. Now that we understand how a microphone works, we need to discuss another very important aspect of microphone design. The pickup pattern is a way of describing the effective use of a microphone. It is often drawn as a polar graph and shows the relative density of different areas around the microphone. This is a very useful tool in selecting which microphone to use for a particular application, as well as how to place it relative to the sound source. Microphone placement is a topic for another video, but these concepts are very important to understand the correct techniques. The most basic pattern is omnidirectional. An omnidirectional microphone effectively has no pickup pattern. Sound coming in from any angle is perceived at the same volume. These end up picking up a fair amount of reflected sound, and you get a lot of the room in your mix. Next, we have the cardioid pickup pattern. There are a few different variations of this pattern, including subcardioid, supercardioid, and hypercardioid. The cardioid patterns are by far the most used in live sound applications. The way that they reject sound from the sides and behind results in a much cleaner signal with limited availability to feedback or pick up spillover sound from other instruments or vocalists. Some microphones have a bi-directional pickup pattern. This is mainly on old ribbon microphones or in some studio microphones. Due to the sensitivity to the reflected signals in the room, this style of mic is not common in live sound. Finally, we have the shotgun mic. These have a long tube on the front that is able to remove most of the signals that are not on the same axis as the mic. These are used a lot in film and theatre, especially when it is not physically possible to get the mic close enough to the source. If we have a look at some three-dimensional models of these pickup patterns, we can see that they exist as bubbles around the microphone. These are the three-dimensional models of a cardioid pickup, an omnidirectional pickup, a bidirectional pickup, and a supercardioid pickup. It is important to note that these imaginary bubbles illustrate which exact points in space the microphone perceives as being at the same volume and at the same frequency. Directional microphones can pick up lower frequencies at a further range than higher frequencies. This gives rise to the proximity effect. Directional mics that are placed too close to the sound source pick up an unusual amount of low end, distorting the signal. Let's briefly discuss the effect of gain on the pickup of a microphone. Gain is the volume control as the mic signal enters the sound console. It does not actually change anything about the mic, it just controls the amplification of the signal. It can, however, be helpful to imagine the 3D bubbles around the microphone that we looked at just before. Think of increasing the gain on a microphone as inflating the bubble around the mic, and decreasing the gain as deflating the bubble. The shape will stay roughly the same, but will grow or shrink. As the bubble gets bigger and bigger, the edges get closer to picking up a drum kit, or worse, the speakers. If the microphone picks itself up in the speaker, an infinite loop is created and the speaker will start to feed back. Finally, I would like to mention the idea of impedance. In an electrical circuit, anything that the electricity passes through will somewhat resist the flow of electrons. Impedance is the measure of how much a microphone, cable, or other audio equipment resists the flow of electrons. The higher the microphone impedance, the more the signal will be degraded, especially over long cable runs. Generally, cheap mics will have a fairly high impedance of as much as 15,000 ohms, while more expensive, higher quality mics will have a lower impedance of fewer than 500 ohms. High impedance microphones often lose a lot of the high frequency detail as the mic cable becomes an analog low pass filter. In summary, there are a few types of microphones. The most common are dynamic and condenser. Condenser mics are much more sensitive and require phantom or battery power to operate. Microphones can have one of many pickup patterns that describe how the microphone interprets sound coming in from different angles. Gain can be used to control the volume and therefore the sensitivity of a microphone. Low impedance microphones will give you a better signal, but generally cost more. Creating a good signal at the source makes the rest of the process much easier. Choosing the correct microphone for the job will give you a better result than trying to create the perfect EQ.